start with Alexander Krizhanovsky from Tempesta. And the word.
Hello, my name is Alexander Krizhanovsky, yes. And I'm CEO and CEO at Tempesta Technologies. And we have Tempesta FW, open source Linux application delivery controller. And also we do custom software development and high performance energy processing and the database. Another examples would be web application firewall, mentioned by other major partners, the medical architecture of the product. And also right now we develop a new feature for MyADB by request of MyADB AD. And the feature will be hopefully in mainstream in MyADB 7.3. Right now you can fetch actual version of the feature from our repository at GitHub. So we started Tempesta FW by request of one of our customers. It was a huge web hosting provider. They actually wanted to protect huge web hosting against very complicated DDoS attacks. And especially they were interested about the cache-related DDoS attacks as the most complicated attacks to detect and prevent. And we started to from patching engineers from nine other open source web integrators, and we quickly realized that modern web integrators are suitable for our tasks. So we had a look at kernel accelerators. They behave a bit better, however, they also didn't satisfy our needs. Basically, we realized that we need some kind of hybrid of a web accelerator and a firewall to be able to process HTTP as fast as possible and generate complex tools to work application where it does. So it must have very fast HTTP accelerator because we still need to process HTTP requests to fight against HTTP views and other DDoS attacks. It must have a very fast web cache to be able to mitigate DDoS attacks if we cannot find out how and work all the bots. Also, we need very strong network set to be able to fight against attacks with many concurrent connections, short-lived HTTP connections, and so on. Also, advanced filtering, I also mentioned the probability. So we started from a hybrid of a web accelerator and a firewall. We were there and we moved to kernel space. During this presentation, I will put a lot of details about current problems with user space web accelerators and explain in details why we move to kernel space. So basically, first prototype of Tempesta was just a web accelerator, a firewall, and since usually web accelerators stay in front of huge server farms, we implemented several web balancing algorithms. As our development moving forward, we implemented more load balancing capabilities. We introduced several few logic to protect against web application attacks. And we also need to use SSL and implement it in kernel space because nowadays an internet application works using HTTPS. Data compression and connection scoring to survive is still in progress. Basically, software and such products are named like application delivery controllers. And typically, you find the mix of the functionality in boxes like F5 or C6. Usually, it's proprietary and cost solutions. objective is that open source has equal solution, equal in performance to these proprietary boxes, and that is fully open source. Typical examples of TPSFW would be the same exactly as for any application here at Toyota. So if you think about more performance and protection, for example, if it's not enough performance from Nginx or other web accelerator, then you might think about hardware box, for example, from 5, to put it in front of your Nginx or Linux file and protect and create your content. And typically, this use case is also used for TPSFW. You can be used in massive CDNs, content management systems, shared hostings, and so on, a lot of use cases. So, we started to discover what's wrong with nowadays web accelerator architecture. So the first thing which we did is to put some DDoS root on Nginx. And surprisingly, we found that Nginx spends a bit more time to work malicious requests rather than survive it from static file. Basically, we use a very small static file. And surely you will see different picture if you use large dynamic content and have an approach. But anyway, we think it's unacceptable to spend a lot of resources to work malicious traffic because we have just a lot of requests from DDoS ports. The problem with Nginx is its very limiting model. Basically, when you need to service such content and block malicious requests, you do exactly the same logic. You must still send error response to new malicious file which you just observed. However, you must run additional logic which is implemented in rate limiting model. So the limiting functionality in Nginx introduces additional logic and additional complexity which takes this one extra microsecond. So to cope with the issues, people usually configure Nginx not to send error response to different clients. And sometimes they use some log passes like fail-to-one to process Nginx access walls and generate in runtime immutable rules. However, the technology based on passing and writing text file looks like 50 years old. It's not fast, and sometimes people recommend to just switch off access walls for better performance. So, it seems I have issues with slides. One might think about writing a Nginx model which will generate rules, IP table rules on the fly. However, generate coupling web accelerator with the firewall is not the whole story. And actually, we have a lot of issues with web accelerators. Actually, any modern web accelerators were designed to deliver content in normal circumstances. So in most cases, they deliver perfect performance for you. And most of the cases means that your clients are innocent, good clients. However, web accelerators like Nginx provide some phishing, and we just saw that phishing is not so fast as it should be to different application where it does text. And also, all the servers are basically designed in early 2000s, when we had an issue to handle 10,000 connections concurrently. It's not a problem to generate 10,000 or 100,000 connections for DDoS botnet. And actually, DDoS is always about corner cases. It means that if your system has a bottleneck, for example, establish a SSH connection, then an attacker can generate exactly an attack against your SSH handshake. If you're not so fast to handle small packets, then attacker can generate flows with a lot of small packets. So DDoS is always about corner cases. And we started in our project to be reliable and stable against the corner cases. So we can deliver stable performance regardless of normal flash calls, the audience, and DDoS attack. So as we analyze it, kernel mode web accelerators behaves a bit better because there's no context switches and so on and so on. However, modern systems, modern operating systems, and modern CPU architectures provide very nice features like zero copy and lazy TLP, which makes context switch very cheap. And kernel accelerators now are dead. However, I will show that if we think about hybrid solution which can defend against DDoS and deliver stable performance for normal operation, we still need kernel access. One of the huge problems which is now addressed by Facebook, Hashtag, and Netflix is TLS. Basically, if you need to send your content through encrypted connection, you must to copy the file content to user space, and after that, you encrypt it and copy again to transmit the content through the encrypted socket. So, the guys tried to move only encryption part of TLS to kernel. So now we can use the serial interface to send file and send the encrypted content without copy. However, TLS and shape remains in user space and it's vulnerable for DDoS attack in shape. So this is why we move it from TLS into the kernel. If we think whether we can take one web server, modern web server, and optimize it and develop further such that it will deliver more performance and will be capable to defend against large DDoS attacks. The answer is not. There's a trace for trace profile for Nginx and simple HTTP boot attack. And we see that the most hotspot is HTTP parser. We also have some copying and network I/O roadness. And finally, this late living router takes also the good place. SSH is top 10 of most hot calls. And we see that the file is actually flat. It means that there is no single point of which you can optimize and increase performance of the server in two times, for example, or in three times. It means that if we need to make a solution, for example, three times faster, we need to rework the core architecture, we need to remove the slow I/O, we need to remove copying and so on. The problem with user space accelerators are also system calls. They should be cheap in nowadays system calls. They still not for free. Typical request handling takes about 9 system calls in Nginx, and we can eliminate only one of them if we disable accessible. By the way, so far I'm talking about Nginx. However, most of the things which I say are also applicable to other web accelerators. And this is just an example which we started for. The other problem is web cache. A lot of web accelerators still use old-fashioned partition-based databases, some kind of databases. because they generate keys in the database using hash on URI and host header. And the funny part begins that you see that there are short directory names, and we have a hierarchy of two layers. And the things are done to cope with slow file system operation. Actually, to find a file in file system having thousands of files is extremely slow operation. File open system calls extremely slow because it requires network lookup and requires disk access. So, Nginx uses cache of open file descriptors and shares the cache mitigation program. However, it's not about stable performance, so you can easily get DDoS attack if you just iterate over all your available resources. So your cache will be efficiently created, and you will run without cache, and you use the great file system on each request. That's a simple case how we can kill such servers. So Apache traffic servers starts to do more clever things, and they implemented some kind of database to handle web cache. So we do the same. Also, this variant HTTP header, which actually requires a secondary key in terms of traditional databases. The problem is, if you have subnet, which can be delivered, which can have different versions, for example, for mobile ones at the bottom and desktop ones at the top, and you want to send different content to different devices. Content has the same URI and host, so it stored in the same file, in the same file system. And you need some kind of secondary key to differentiate web users from desktop users. So you use the secondary key, and if where is this file's user agent, then you can take care about user agent value and generate different content for secondary key. So all in all, we need a real database to efficiently handle web content with stable performance results. The next thing is HTTP parser. As we just saw, HTTP parser is a hotspot in under DDoS root. And surprisingly, most of HTTP servers use old-fashioned dummy approach to process HTTP. This example of HTTP parser state machine. So we have a while loop with a switch statement, and now we have a state variable with value. Again, we have value 1, we have the state 1, and we have input chapter B. So we start from checking state variable, we move to proper state with corresponding to proper chapter, and we assign the value to state variable. Next, we move to end of while and switch statement. Keep in mind that at this point we fetch at least three cache lines of code cache. The first cache line we fetch at the beginning of while and case statement. The second line we fetch at processing phase B when we assign it value to the state variable. And the third line is fetched right now at the end of the loop and switch statement. Now we move to the beginning of the loop. We start to check state variable again. And finally, we go to state 2. If we look at the picture and try to understand what's happening, we see just a lot of spinning around the code. Reason, at state 1 and given chapter B as input, we know precisely where we need to go. In this case, we can just fetch the next instruction, we don't need any jump at all. So our CPU prefetches would work perfectly. If you would be in state 1 and case A, we need to jump, but we again know exactly where we need to be. We actually do not need the dummy state variable. We don't handle it, and we can save a lot of fortune. This parcel is actually generated by waging code generator. And we do apply the same logic in our parcel, and we also split states, set of states in different pieces to generate a slow switch jump table as possible. So we apply different optimization strategy to make the jumps and processing as fast as possible. Well, HTTP is actually a text protocol. This is version 1.1. So you can easily get very large strings. It could be a cookie. We saw with the agent about 65 kilobytes in size. It could be cookies, your eyes, with the agent. So sometimes you need to process very long strings. Since we have a mix to HTTP extension for about 3 years, HTTP still doesn't use the extension in their configurations. Moreover, HTTP strings is a very special case. There are different points which makes HTTP strings special. And they are all important in optimization of string processing in HTTP case. The first one is that actually we do not need to treat DOI in a special way. Actually, we have several binary calls in ASCII, and we should treat DOI the same way. Secondly, there are special derivatives, and CRLF makes a real trouble for us. Because if we are creating zero copy fashion, CRLF will be in one packet, LLF will be in other packet, and we have to keep function state machine states between the receiving the path of the derivative. Also, some basic wires sends just the LLF as a wire terminated in DDoS. We have to handle the terminator the same way. In HTTP path, when you put your own HTTP path, you definitely have some such things. For example, it could be names of HTTP headers which you want to process special way. For example, host header, user agent header, cookie header, and so on. So these names are encoded in HTTP path indexes. So you have constant strings. So when you compare input string against this constant string, you don't need to compare case of the second string. You need actually only one case conversion for input string only. And you can save necessary iterations. And in the same case, CMP compares strings of both cases of both of the strings. If you need to validate input string against the word alphabet, you might think about using STL SPM to accept or reject some alphabets. And this is a bad idea because STL-SPM spends just incredibly many resources to compile, accept, reject sets. Basically, HTTP has only several word alphabets for different HTTP headers and URI, and you can encode the sets directly in your HTTP parser. In some of modern HTTP servers, there are attempts to do strings processing like matching HTTP header names using file state machine as we just saw previous slide, and the performance of such passes are very, very slow. The last thing about modern web accelerators is network I/O. Actually, we can consider an example on the slide. There are three packets, and left each packet contains four HTTP messages. So, firstly, we read the packets in software queue, and software queue places the packet in input queue of sockets. After that, software queue wakes up process owning the socket, and process starts to copy the data from kernel to user space, process HTTP, and do some other logic. So when process finishes with the first socket, it can find the packets on the second socket waiting out of the cache. DTA technology, DD cache technology from Intel shines in this situation. However, DTA places network packets in WAN 3 of CPU cache. However, if you want to process 10 gigabits network traffic, WAN 3 cache will be not enough to wait while user space process pass HTTP, copy data, and so on. So in Tempesta, we directly built in HTTP parser into HTTP IPsec, and all the packets are processed as soon as possible, while all the data in CPU cache. So all the issues which I just mentioned are addressed in Tempesta FW. And this is a hybrid of HTTP IPsec and the firewall. Actually, it's multi-way firewall because it uses firewall rules and IPware and HTTPware. It's built in HTTP IPsec. And we ship built-in filters to fight against web server DDoS and web application attacks. As I told, we employ faster HTTP parser. We have a specially designated in-memory database, which is malware and hardly optimized for modern hardware. We have advanced load balancing schedules, and I will cover the topics in next slide. I want to start from benchmarks. Benchmark results and description. How did we do the benchmark such that you can reproduce the results? You can find them in our wiki. And the slide shows that we can reach 1.8 million requests per second on 4 cores CPU. It's one of the cheapest CPUs. If we analyze the performance result carefully, basically this is somewhat 3 times faster than well-tuned next generation of the same CPU. We should be much more faster than the DDoS condition because we have that integrated firewall. We can work twice more faster than any Nginx processing while using very limited failed one and so on. However, it's basically very difficult to produce DDoS logs. I mean, it's very difficult to emulate DDoS workload in test labs. For example, we have about 3 servers now test bed, and real DDoS is not possible to emulate in this environment. The next interesting result is about popular user space HTTP IPsecs. And one of the examples of web HTTP servers implemented on top of user space accelerators is SealStar. Basically, it's not so clear for me from their performance benchmark whether they whether the 1.3 million requests per second for 4 cores or 4 hyperthreads. But either way, CSR beat slower or beat faster than Tempesta FW. So basically, we are comparable in performance for normal TP process with good user space security stacks. However, we do not have drawback of such approaches because Tempesta is actually Linux. It's built into Linux kernel. It's probably we can argue about this approach, probably it's not so good. However, we fully integrated with any Linux utilities. For example, if you need to write some IP table rules and the traffic which is passed to the double will be treated by IP tables. Go ahead and do that. If you need to run speed up and analyze traffic, but that's why you can still do that. You can use traffic control to distribute traffic, to control traffic, which is passing through Tempesta and so on. So basically, if you need to do such things in user space step itself, you either must re-implement them for user space step, or you need to use some dummy interfaces with scoping and additional overheads. So our approach is, yes, we know that growing vector system is not good, but we argue to not to copy code twice. It's not good for vector system world to execute two copies of TCP steps on the same system. If you need to go further, you need to run two firewalls to the same system, you need to run two individual servers and whatever. You just do not copy and redo the right support and rewrite by smart vector system developers. Also, I want to mention that while there are a lot of TCP/IP steps implemented in user space, you can imagine how large TCP stack is. And basically, a lot of user space TCP steps don't have good extensions like security acknowledgements, different TCP congestion control algorithms, and so on. So actually, TCP/IP stack of Linux is good and fast, and we can avoid it, and we can live with it. Let's have a look at TPS architecture. So if we have packets going to network adapter, we check it against our rules and where we next we process it in HTTP parser and run analyzing model text ways and analyze already passed HTTP request and apply HTTP rules against it. If it decides that the request is malicious, it will generate new rule which will be put to where theme and we will just block the request. If the request is good, then we can pass it to upstream or to pass to our cache. As I said, we use common circuits. Since we live in Linux kernel, we do not use file descriptors, we do not use input queues, and so on. So there are no walls. However, the case why user space HTTP accelerators are slow, while we still see very good numbers for user space HTTP, is that real world HTTP server must solve different issues. One of the issues is proxying HTTP requests. In this example, we have two sockets. First one is client, the second one is server socket. We have two CPUs. And basically, if you have a bidirectional connection between client and server, client sends new request, like using HTTP by client and server, response to previous request. Then you might want to take a log of HTTP control blocks in different order, and you easily can go to that log. This hard thing will still need to solve it using user space HTTP step. And in our project, we use the CPU interconnection transport. We use thin buffers per CPU. And if we consider traffic from 1 to 7, first the package is processed on TCP protocol work. Now we have no working because all TCP protocol blocks are bidded to work with CPU, so Faraday CPU cannot access to work all servers. So first we process the incoming packet to on the first TCP protocol work. Next we always request the lead buffer of server socket, and CPU which handles socket will do actual transfer to server. So there's no working. We have great performance on index traffic and low latency for web. So also we are very good if you need low latency HPC wise. We did a preliminary performance measurements in 2015 of synchronous circuits. We see that the blue line of synchronous circuits much faster establish new connection in comparison with user space circuits and other kernel space circuits. Also, we have more stable and more performance in processing HTTP packets. Also compared with all other kernel circuits. I already said about HTTP processing. You can find algorithms about HTTP parser and particular streams processing in our blog. And not just a few numbers. We get faster than engineers in 1.6-1.8 times in short HTTP requests. However, if you go to long streams, for example, with reaction or URI, it's something about 1 kilobyte, it's not so reaction, not so reaction URI. The URI cookies or such things, it's very common nowadays. And our stream processing can be faster 3 or 6 times the VT and user space computations. We also use a dedicated web cache. It's basically on top of NumaWare architecture. NumaWare means that we can copy data on Numa nodes to be able to survive requests from local Numa node, or we can do sharding computing which node will respond. And we use our own unique algorithms, that is captured to for faster index in the database. Basically, it's based on modern research crash conscious data searches. And the core idea of the data search is that we have an array of very short offsets in one CPU cache wire. So we have 16 cache wires. If you want to find some stream, we calculate cache value, and we use less significant 4 bits. Since now we have more data, we just allocate new data page and place data in it. If we find that our data page is full, we have a lot of collisions, then we pass the node. During the pass, we allocate new index node, which is over the second 4 bits, and we have to split our data page, and this is the only place we use locks. Any other places, operations with the data structure are lock-free. So, basically, Tempesta provides several limiting functionality for DDoS attacks. You can also defend against low HTTP attacks, specifying time limits and chunk numbers. It's basically very hard to do in user space because you do not control the number of pages. Also, you have a protection against several web attacks, for example, HTTP response bridge. We account carefully HTTP requests and responses. Basically, we constantly grow in our set of filtering logic. However, we do only very fast logic. if we feel that we need to do some complex logic, for example, to process XML in responses or something like that, we leave the logic for user space web application files. So the point of TPS is just to learn very fast logic and quickly analyze the traffic. We have also what viruses. I would say probably some of them are known. For example, the DDoS hashing is stable to firewall. We use machine learning technology in adaptive and predictive schedule. We analyze how quickly server replies to a request and build trends against it. I would skip example configuration. We have a sticky cookies to fight against DDoS, which are unable to solve cookie challenges and provide sticky session decision scheduling. Prerequisites are great because we use modern CPU features. Finally, I just want to address some of questions and concerns about the project. Firstly, TPS is a very small piece of project. It's much smaller than any modern file system. We do not try to move any project from HTTP directly to the kernel. Moreover, we are going to deliver fast transfer to user space of parsed HTTP messages. And typically, we will deliver a web application firewall which is more capable with standard functionality in user space. We use best practices in Linux kernel development. You can find our pull requests and what we use at our GitHub. We will deliver packages, so you not need to build kernel and Tempest by hand. So as a result, as conclusion, Tempest FW is very good if you need a lot of performance when traditional HTTP servers are not enough for you, and when you need to defend efficiently against various DDoS attacks. So thank you. Our site is powered by Tempest FW for 9 months. We didn't see any failure during the time. Availability is at our GitHub. Any contribution are very welcome. And you can find algorithms and so on at our blog. So thank you for listening. Just a few minutes for questions.
Do we have questions, please?
No questions.
No one from the audience. So this is available and compilable to the kernel.
Or
your code is available, I see, and it's compilable to the actual kernel version.
Yes.
You see, your site is powered by your own product, obviously.
Yeah, we have a patch in for the kernel. You can download it from our GitHub, and we have a kernel model. So it's not a Linux mainstream so far. Hopefully, we will be in the mainstream some time in the future, but not now. Did I answer your question?
Yeah, thank you. Some more, if not. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
For having me here. It was very interesting. Maybe you close. One more.
Thank you.